are created to enjoy music. Music is a part of worship. We'd like for you to join in our worship today and singing some hymns. Let's start with page 70 in your hymnal, page 70.
Thank you. Want to say good morning and happy Sabbath. I want to say, first of all, welcome to the visitors and guests here today. And I want to say we have a full capacity of the church. This is a chance of our service that we get to give back to God, a portion of what we've given to Him. And I want to say, first of all, that the loose offerings go for the church budget. And I'm reading from Malachi 4:3. It says, "Bring ye forth the fruits from the storehouse into the church, and every tithes together for all the world, and to do the work we've given to do." At this point in time, let's have prayer in advance for the tithes and offerings. Read from Malachi 3, verse 10. It states, "Bring ye forth the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to test, says the Lord of hosts. If it not, open up the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you an overflowing blessing." Tithes and offerings are very important for us, and it's a joy to give back a portion of what God has given us. But before we do so, let us pray in advance for these tithes and offerings. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, as we come humbly before your throne of grace, we ask that you send your commandment-keeping angels to dwell in your heavenly sanctuary to dwell down in our midst at this time. Dear Lord, we ask you bless the hands of a cheerful giver. Bless those that could give today, and also bless those that couldn't give today as well. Dear Lord, we also ask that these blessings and all these tithes that we give you be equal to what we know you'll give us, that we have no even matter to even think about how much you're going to bless us, dear Lord. So we thank you so very much for this opportunity. And dear Lord, we ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings, that they may spread the three angels' message to a world that eagerly needs to hear this message, and those who never heard about the Sabbath truth as well also, dear Lord. Dear Lord, all these things we ask in your most holy precious name we pray, dear Lord. Amen. Amen. Will the deacons please rise for the collection of the tithes and offerings?
Money. I come to the garden alone, while the tomb is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. He gave to me with them. the joy we share as we tarry there. None ever has ever known. And he walked with me and he talked with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. None other has ever known.
Prayer. Prayer is a direct channel that we have to God. And now it's time for our intercessory prayer. If you're in need of prayer and you feel like you want to come down to the altar, come down. Please come down. It's an opportunity now for us to petition God as a group. And not only for ourselves, but on behalf of others. As far as possible, let us kneel as we address our God. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, you are the creator of the universe. You know us better than we know ourselves. You know all of our needs before we even ask. Lord, we want to thank you for giving your Son to die in our place. And Father, this morning we want to ask you for forgiveness for our sins. Not only as individuals, but corporately. Lord, there are so many ways that we fall short, and we ask you to forgive us. We ask for your guidance in the future, for your Holy Spirit to be with us, to show us the ways that we need to mend our ways. Lord, because only with your guidance can we follow the path that leads to eternal life. Lord, you sent your Son to die in our place, and for that we thank you. And we know that only through Jesus, the blood of Jesus Christ, can we be saved. Lord, we thank you for that shed blood. Dear Father, this morning we want to think about our families, about the children that families that may not be here this morning. We want to pray for each member that's not here and for each member of each family that's missing. Father, we want to remember the people that are sick in our congregation and uplift them to you and ask you, Lord, for healing. Father, we want to thank you for all the many blessings that you give us every day. Dear Lord, we want to ask you for safe passage for Andre and Juliet as they bring their family back home. We thank you, Lord, that this process of adoption has gone so well, Lord, and we just want to pray that you'll see it through to the end. Lord, I want to pray this morning for every family that's represented here. I want to ask your blessing on each family. Lord, I would like to ask you for guidance for our country and ask for your protection for our troops that are overseas. Lord, we pray for the members that are missing and ask, Lord, that you'll bring them back. And as we grow closer and closer to the end of time, Father, we ask for your guidance and we ask that you will cleanse us from our sins. In Jesus' name, amen.
And happy Sabbath, everyone. It is a delight to be here today. I am Marty Kiel Silva, and in behalf of the Orange Cove Church, I would like to welcome all of you here today, even if you're a member. Amen? And especially if you're visiting for the very first time, the Orange Cove welcomes you. And we would like to welcome those that are watching online, streamed live. I believe they stream the services live. So if you're tuning in anywhere in the world, welcome. Amen? Probably Pastor Andre might be watching this sermon as well. I believe he is. So we're praying for you, and welcome. All right, give me a couple of minutes here to get this computer working. Amen. I would like to thank Brother Jasper for all his dedication in preparing. He came here on Friday morning when I was home working on the sermon. He came in here and arranged everything so I could control the PowerPoint presentation from up here. So thank you so much for your dedication, brother. We appreciate that, and I'm sure the Orange Cove Church appreciates you as well. Amen? All righty, let's see here what I can get. Let's see if this is going to work. If it doesn't, it's not his fault. There you go. Alrighty. Well, let's bow our heads and we begin our sermon this morning. Amen. Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, confessing that you are the Son of the living God. Father, we thank you so much for dying on the cross and shedding your blood for us in behalf of us sinners. And Lord, we are grateful for your mercy and grace that you share and impart to us each day. Father, as we open your word this morning, we ask, Father, please, that your Holy Spirit may be manifested in this place. Open, Lord, our hearts and our minds and our understanding, Lord. We pray that the words that we hear here today, we would cherish and take it with us, not only for this today, but for the years to come. It is our prayer in the most precious name of Jesus. Amen. You know, I don't want to encourage you by any means, I don't want you to think that I'm trying to endorse playing the lottery at all. I am not, okay? However, if somebody that is involved in the lottery came up to you and says, look, I am about to reveal to you the winning numbers for next week, and you knew that person meant business, you knew he was serious, what would you do? Would you pay attention to the words that person was saying and cherish that with all your heart? Okay, you don't have to say, because I know you're good at Venice, you don't play the lottery. But you know what? The message that you're about to hear here today, and I don't say this to sound sensationalistic, I believe a time is soon coming that it will be more desirable, the words you're about to hear will be more desirable and more precious than any lottery prize the government can pay. Amen? Because it's about your life. I believe the message you're about to hear today will give you what you need and allow you to maintain your faith through the time of trouble. Amen? I will be speaking here this Sabbath and the following. And today, it is a preparation for what's coming next week. Amen? Because there's order in studying the Bible. All right, so today, the topic of my sermon is the full cup principle. The full cup principle. Amen? God's love is poorly understood in the world today. You know, the Bible declares that God is love, 1 John 4, 7 and 8. But today, even in the church, God's love is poorly understood. The meaning of love has been so distorted by sin that many people just do not understand what love is. Amen? You see, God's love is revealed in a perfect balance. A perfect what? Balance between justice and mercy. But because of sin, men's senses of balance between justice and mercy have become distorted. And as a result, people have a poor understanding about the love and the character of God. You know, God's character is so distorted that for many people, God is nothing more than a mighty teddy bear that you can use and abuse anytime you want, or a good old Santa Claus that knows all your wishes and gives us everything you want whenever we want. Nowadays, we hear a lot of noise about the grace and the love of God. You have mega churches with thousands of people, and that is the only thing they talk about, is the love of God and the grace of God in a shallow manner. However, very little or nothing is ever said about the justice of God. So my sermon this morning, it's not a one that you're going to hear every single day in different churches, because I'm about to speak about the justice of God. Amen? Can you handle that? Amen? So, as a result, we have created an imaginary God, an icon we have come to call Jesus, which is not the real Jesus at all, but a customized and fabricated Jesus created according to our own standard desires and wishes. The Bible says that in the beginning, God created man in his image. I have news for you. We have created him in ours nowadays. This is why we do not understand the Old Testament in relation to the New. This is why we do not understand the actions of God in the Old Testament. This is why the New and the Old Testament have become two distinct books, totally separate from one another, with two different gods. In the New Testament, we find a good Jesus. In the Old Testament, we find a mean, grumpy God we have come to know as the Father. And this is our understanding about God. When in reality, as I shared with you a year ago in this church, 90% of all verses and mentions of God the Father in the Old Testament is pertaining to Jesus. But we do not understand those simple things. Beloved, a sad truth is that we do not understand the character of God. As a result, we have lost the sense of fairness and discernment. Lawlessness and sin have become accepted even among Christians. Today, we live in a land where sin and abomination not only are protected by law, but are legislated. I mean, think about how deep we have fallen. Think about that. We are in a hole, and we do not even realize, just like the Sabbath school said today. And the sad thing is that it's all normal to us because we're so deep into this. You know, as a result of our wickedness, it appears that God has become silent. Our corporate sin, it's so offensive to God that it has separated us from his presence. And as generations come and go, the reality of God becomes dimmer, knowledge of God becomes fainter, and sin becomes more and more attractive and less offensive. Am I lying? Violence and sorrow, suffering is spreading like wildfire. Every night, the evening news confirmed that human beings are indulged in violence and depravity. Hideous sins are either glamorized or justified or treated as inconsequential on television. And not surprisingly, the people that claim to be waiting for the soon return of Christ are treating this kind of wickedness as a form of entertainment. See, sin is like the drug Novocaine. It deadens our senses of fairness and makes us numb. Sin causes us to minimize promiscuity and the suffering that results from wrong deeds. And it causes us to avoid at all costs any penalty related with wrongful behavior. I mean, how many people, if given the chance, how many people would be willing to stay in prison and pay the full penalty for their deeds if they had just a chance to get out? If they could come out? Not many. Because this is the condition of the world today. As I have said before, it appears that God is silent. But I'm here this morning to tell you that God will not be silent forever. Amen? The Bible confirms that God breaks His silence from time to time by using one or more of His dreadful judgment, as the Bible calls it. And this He does to limit the growth of sin, Ezekiel 14:21. I'll be talking about that in details the following Sabbath, so you need to come to hear next week's sermon. Amen? But today we're building a foundation so that we can understand the actions of God. All right, so understanding the God's full cup principle. This is what we are talking about here today. Well, we understand, and you well know from Scripture, that God changes. He is the one who changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. Amen? Don't we know that? Yes, we do. Daniel 2:21. And we also know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of man, and He gives it. He takes it away, and He gives it to whomever He will, and He sets up over it to the lowest of men. In other words, the Bible says that God is the one responsible for setting up kings in the thrones and taking down kings. And God is responsible for taking away kingdoms and giving to somebody else. He's the one in charge. It doesn't appear that way, but you better believe it. Can I hear you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, in His infinite wisdom, God allows a nation or a people to have power until it fills its cup of iniquity. And its cup of what?
Iniquity.
And when it does, when that cup is filled to the brim, the Bible says He removes that nation from power. See, most Christians know and they have heard about something about the love of God. But most people do not realize the Bible also says that God has wrath. Notice what the Bible says. Romans 1:18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of man. Did you notice that God's wrath is revealed against the unrighteousness of men, not men themselves? Amen? Colossians 3:5 and 6. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming on the earth. Insertions are mine. Revelation 15:1. And I saw another great and marvelous sign, seven angels with seven last plagues, last because with them God's wrath is what?
Completed.
You see, because God's character has both properties, love and wrath, it is hard sometimes for us to reconcile these two attributes. All right? So please consider the perfect balance between God's love and God's wrath. Bible history reveals that God, when dealing with humanity, He follows a consistent principle. A what, everyone? Consistent principle. This principle is called the full cup principle because the Bible often uses the metaphor of a cup to indicate the fullness of an experience. For example, consider the words of Jesus just before He was arrested and crucified. He said, "My Father, if it is possible, may this bitter cup instructions are mine. May this bitter cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. So in this passage, a cup refers to a bitter experience. Can you see that? See, Jesus didn't want to endure the experience of a bitter death, of a bitter cup, but he was willing to do so if this was the only way to save humanity. But notice, the metaphor of a cup can also be used to indicate a joyful experience. You know, consider the well-known words of David in Psalms 23:5. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and what? My cup of joy overflows. So King David uses the metaphor of an overflowing cup to express an overflowing experience of joy. Can you see that? You know, from these two examples, we see that a cup represents an experience, and the contents in the cup indicate the type of experience. Amen? Now, notice how God used the metaphor of a cup in Jeremiah's day. In whose days, everyone? Jeremiah's day. Excuse me for a second. Notice. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, said to me. Take from my hand this what? Cup. Filled to the brim. Insertions are mine. You're going to often see a little insertions in pink, and I usually do that for clarification. You take from my hand this cup filled to the brim with the wine of my wrath, and make all nations to whom I send you to drink it. When they drink it, they will stagger and go mad because of the sword I will send among them. So I took the cup from the Lord's hand and made all the nations to whom he sent me to drink it. Jeremiah 25:15-17. Now please compare the words of Jeremiah with the warning that God's servants, the 144,000, will proclaim to the inhabitants of the earth during the Great Tribulation. If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on the forehead or on the hand, he too will drink of the wine of God's what? Fury, which is poured out full strength into the what? Cup of his wrath. This is why those that worship the beast will drink the cup poured out full strength. Incidentally, this is the same. I mean, Jesus himself had to taste of that bitter cup, as we've seen in previous verses. Now, the full cup principle is based on the idea that God measures the actions of mankind. Every time we do wrong, we add a drop of sin to our cup of grace. When all of God's grace has been displaced by willful sin, by what, everyone? Willful sin, our cup becomes full of bitterness, and we have to drink the consequences of our actions. In a similar way, God measures the actions of nations. Amen? Are you following that? Do you remember the words of Daniel that he spoke to King Belshazzar the night he saw the handwriting on the wall? Daniel said, this is what these words on the wall mean. Many, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tekel, you have been weighed on the scale and found wanting. And Perez, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Daniel 5:25-28. You see, the moment Babylon filled its cup, it was all over. You know, then God responded immediately. You know, which teaches us that God's patience with man's arrogance and defiance has limits. Amen? Now, please allow yourselves to hear this. Throughout the Old Testament, consistently, what everyone? Consistently, we see that when the cup of transgression is nearly full, God always breaks his silence by first sending a warning through his selected messengers, his servants, the prophets. Okay? Notice one of many examples that I don't have time to give you in the Bible. And though the Lord has sent all his servants, the prophets, to you again and again. What did they do? You have not listened or paid attention. Jeremiah 25:4. See, God always sends divine warnings before carrying on divine judgment or divine destruction. God always sends divine warnings before he sends divine destructions. I said that twice because I want you to hear it. In fact, the Bible says that surely the sovereign Lord does how much?
Nothing.
Without he revealing his plans to his servants, the prophets, so that the prophets could tell the people. In other words, God always warns the people before bringing destruction. And this is exactly right before the great tribulation begins. God will select and seal 144,000 prophets to proclaim his everlasting gospel to the whole world before he brings divine destruction. This is how the inhabitants of the whole world, Hindus, Jews, Muslims, atheists, will hear the gospel, the everlasting gospel, and carefully consider it. But that's another study, all of itself. Amen? See, God first warns the people, but if the warning does not work, and the people do not heed to the prophet's warnings, then God uses one or more of his four dreadful judgments. In other words, if the situation is redeemable, his judgments are redemptive. If the situation goes beyond redemption, his judgments are totally destructive. This is exactly what happened at the time of the flood. You know, the flood puzzles a lot of people. We do not understand the flood. We do not understand the things that happen in life, some of the things that happen in life. See, the people in Noah's day had filled up their cup to the brim. Notice, Genesis 6:5-7, the Bible says, "The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on earth had become." What did he saw? What did he see? Though how wickedness of the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart, speaking of man, was only evil all the time. All the time. And then, the Lord was grieved that he had made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with what? Does God bring destruction? Is that something easy for God? Does he like doing, enjoy doing that? No. His heart is filled with pain. So the Lord said, "I will wipe mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, man and animals and creatures that move along the ground and birds of the air, for I am grieved that I have made them." Now, please notice, first, God broke his silence and warned the world through Noah that a flood was coming. Then, once the antediluvian cup of iniquity have reached full measure, God destroyed all but eight of the inhabitants of the world. For God says, "My spirit shall not always strive with men." Genesis 6:3, Psalms 103:9. Amen? Now, here is the very important principle that we must learn. Please, if you don't learn anything today, remember this principle. When extended mercy fails to produce repentance and reformation in people's lives, As with the antediluvians, God's justice demands destructive actions. In other words, when the mercy of God has no more redeeming effect on the people, it's all over. God sends his judgments. In other words, when the grace of God has no more redeeming power in people's lives, there is no more point of allowing to go on. What would be the point? If the grace of God has no more redeeming power, there is no more point. And what God does, he then sends divine judgments. He intervenes divine judgments. And I'm going to explain to you next week why exactly God does that. And you can be assured that everything God does is out of love. Amen? See, we're dealing with life's most difficult questions. You know, as I said, people do not comprehend. We have a hard time understanding why God opened up the floor and killed 17,000 in the desert. We have a hard time why God would destroy men and women, old and children, and pregnant ladies at the flood by the millions. We have a hard time comprehending. But let me try to help you understand. Let's suppose, for example, that you contracted a flesh-eating bacteria and you're about to lose your hand or your leg, and you go to see your doctor and the doctor says there is no cure for this disease. And unless you amputate that leg, within 24 hours the whole body will be contaminated and you will die. What would you do? There goes a leg, right? I mean, would it be an easy choice? Not at all. Because you love that leg. You need that leg so much. But do you need to let that leg go for the sake of the whole body? Amen? See, because God has love for future generations, he had to destroy millions of wicked people at a flood. Had he not destroyed the wicked people at a flood, you and I would not be here today, because their wickedness would have gotten to us and we would have been contaminated. And it would have been just as wicked as they. Do you understand why God did it? It is not a pretty thing. It is not a pretty sight. God takes no pleasure. But it's necessary in order for future generations to be able to enjoy life and to give them a fair chance. Amen? Now, all right. Now, let's talk about the Amorites and the full cup principle. And I'm going to try not to hold you up here for too long today. They said no more than an hour and a half, so no worries. Yeah, so I know lunch has to be ready by one, so or two, or I'm just kidding. So the Amorites and the full cup principle. About 400 years before the Israelites went into captivity in Egypt, the Bible records a very, very interesting story between God and Abraham. Between God and who? Abraham. So this meeting, listen very carefully, this meeting of God and Abraham took place on the same exactly land of Canaan, okay? And which 400 years later, that same land would be given to the Israelites as the promised land. But at that time, it was inhabited by the Amorites and the Canaanites, not the Israelites. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yes. Now, please notice what the interesting account that the Bible records. Genesis 15, 13 through 16. The Lord said to him, Abraham, "Know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and mistreated 400 years. How long? Does God know the future? This is 400 years before the Exodus, before going into Egypt. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, And afterwards, they will come out with great possessions. Did it happen? Oh, yes, it did. You, however, will go into your fathers in peace. You're going to die and be buried at a good old age. And in the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here to the same land. For the what? Sin of the Amorites has what? Not yet reached its full measure. Did you get that? God waited until the Amorites had filled their cup of iniquity. And once their cup was full, God brought judgment upon them by removing them from the land and giving it to the Israelites. In other words, God did not just evict the Amorites and stole their lands, to give it to the Israelites. Not at all. But they evicted themselves by filling up their own cup of iniquity. Then the Father sent divine judgment upon them. See, God promised to give Canaan to Abraham's offspring only after the sins of the Amorites had reached their full measure. God does not steal. He didn't just steal to one to give to another. And that's often misunderstood. See, in other words, the Israelites received the promised land not because they were good, not because of their own righteousness, not because they deserved, but on the account of the iniquity of the people that lived there before them. Likewise, if you and I ever inherit the promised land, it will not be because of my own or your own righteousness or our own goodness, but because of His perfect righteousness. Amen? You see, notice what the Bible says. Be assured today that the Lord your God is the one who goes across ahead of you like a devouring fire. The Lord is telling the Israelites before they enter the promised land. He will destroy them, the people that lived in the land. He will subdue them before you, and you will drive them out and annihilate them quickly, as the Lord has promised you. And after the Lord your God has driven them out before you, do not say to yourselves, the Lord has brought me here to take possession of this land because of my righteousness. No, it is on the account of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is going to drive them out before you. Verse 5, it is not because of your righteousness or of your integrity that you are going to take possession of their land, but on the account of the what? Of these nations that the Lord your God will drive them out before you to accomplish what He swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Do you see what I'm saying? Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? See, I hope you have begun by now to understand how the full cup principle works. Now, keep in mind also that Israel's possession of Canaan, Israel's what? Possession of Canaan was based on the same conditions that apply to the Amorites. This is not known by the Christian world today. They think that God gave it to them unconditionally. But no, contrary to what a lot of people think today, Israel's possession of Canaan has always been what? Conditional. Now, please notice what Moses warned Israel before they enter the promised land. First, he lists all this. Moses gives this list of sins, all these things, and then he goes on to says, do not defile yourself in any of these ways, because this is how the nations that I am going to drive out before you became defiled. And it says, even the land was defiled, so I punished it for its sin, and the land vomited out its inhabitants. For all these things were done by the people who lived in the land before you, and the land became what? And if you defile the land, did you hear that condition there? If you defile the land, It will vomit you out as it vomited out the nations that were before you. Wow. Wow. Are you hearing that? That is absolutely amazing. The condition there. Now, if you defile the land will vomit you out. More on this next week. Amen? So, but you know the story very well. 430 years after the Israelites possessed Canaan, the nation of Israel also filled its cup of sin. And then, in 605 BC, God drove the Israelites out of the land, just as he has promised through the prophet Jeremiah. Now, notice the words of warning that God gave to Jeremiah just a few years before the Babylonian captivity in 605 BC. Notice the words. But you did not listen to me, declared the Lord, and you have provoked me with what your hands have made, and you have brought what? Harm to yourselves. Therefore, the Lord Almighty says this, because you have not listened to my words, I will summon all the people from the north. By the way, destruction in the Bible always comes from the north. And my what?
Servant.
What?
Servant.
My servant who? Wow, a pagan king, huh? God called him servant. Wow. King of Babylon, declares the Lord. See, if you're wondering why God calls a pagan king, not a Jew, not a Christian, his servant, that's a fascinating study of itself, but I need to come back another time. Amen? All right, it's getting late and we need to wrap these things up here, right? So let me summarize what I have told you so far. So we have learned that the Amorites filled their cup of sin. And then what did God do? God brought divine judgment, took the land away from them, kicked them out of the land, and gave it to somebody else. And who was that? The Israelites. The Israelites lived in the land. They also filled their cup of iniquity. And once that cup was full, God did what? Kicked them out, gave the land to somebody else. All right? Now, then, once again, notice how God is so consistent with his full cup principle. Once Babylon's cup was filled, whose cup?
Babylon.
God sent another destroyer. Who sent it? God. To punish it for its iniquity. Notice the words of Jeremiah. This is what the Lord says. See, God is saying, I will stir up the spirit of a destroyer against Babylon and the people of Lab Kamai. And of course, this is another principle that I'm not going to get into it right now. Okay? But in times of apostasy, God always sends a destroyer. You need to read Revelation 9 very carefully to understand what I'm saying here. But the moment Babylon's cup had become full, God rose another destroyer to punish them. Okay? And if you remember a little bit of Bible history, who did God use to punish the kings of Babylon? Absolutely. The kings of the Medes and the Persians. Look, Jeremiah 51:11, sharpen the arrows, take up the shields. The Lord has stirred up the kings of the Medes because his purpose is to what? Destroy Babylon. The Lord will take vengeance for his temple. Remember how they stole the articles of the temple and they commit abomination and use it in debauchery, and the Lord sent the hands on writing on the wall in Daniel 5? Are you with me? All right. So conclusion, this proves that God deals fairly with all nations. Amen? In God's eyes, wickedness is wickedness. Each person, city, nation, and kingdom has a cup. And when that cup becomes full, God breaks his silence. Now, because God is always consistent, we discover an interesting truth. Civilizations rise and fall by divine decree. Amen? See, friends, in closing this morning, now that you understand the full cup principle, listen very carefully. Now that you understand the full cup principle, and I can give you several more examples, but I don't have the time. You can begin to grasp why God is about to pour out his wrath upon this world in a form of a terrible time of trouble. When nations are legislating immorality, abomination is defended by constitution, we have corporately almost reached, filled up our cup of iniquity. And the world too, likewise. So you can understand why God needs to break his silence and pour out his wrath upon the world in the form of a terrible time of trouble. Solution to the world that we live in today? A time of trouble. Now, God's divine destruction. Notice the words of Jesus. Matthew 24, 21 and 22. For then, this is his predicting about the end times. For then there will be such as has not been since the beginning of the world until that time. This time, he's talking about the future. He's saying, from the beginning of the world, the time of trouble will be worse than anything that has ever happened from the beginning until this time that he's speaking of. Okay? And then he says, no, nor ever shall be. There will never be another time such as worse than that. And then he says, unless those days were cut short or shortened, no flesh, that means nobody, would be saved or would survive. And he says, but for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. See, I hope you're hearing the words of Jesus. This means that the time of trouble will be far worse than any other event that we ever presently know. The flood, way worse. Time of trouble, worse. The Holocaust, 11 million people, way worse. The bubonic plague, within 5 years, 25 million people, not even close. You see, we have somehow have come and brought this idea into our minds that the time of trouble will be a little Sunday law, and there will be a little persecution here and there, and some people will die, and then Michael will step up and deliver the saints. How does that compare to the words of Jesus that we just read? That scenario is very irrelevant to what we have read. Jesus says nothing will be compared to that time. May I suggest to you, brothers and sisters, that there is a lot more to the story that you and I are not aware of. And I invite you as individuals to humbly, humbly submit to the leading of the Holy Spirit and humbly pull out that dusty Bible and begin studying it again. But there's a problem. The reason why I say to you as individuals, because as a church it's not going to happen. Because the Lord already told us. There is something called the Laodicean attitude that prevents us from learning. Just like any other church, the Laodicean attitude prevents us from learning beyond what we presently know. Because we have become rich, we have need of nothing. Nothing. We have it all. We have all the doctrines. We know everything there is to know. But we do not know that we are miserable, poor, naked, and blind. And I counsel you to buy
of that oil, of that salve, that you put, anoint your eyes with it that you may see. Isn't that what the Lord says? So as individuals, I'm calling you as individuals to move beyond and not be satisfied and pull your old Bibles and begin studying. Because there's a lot more to the story than we know. Would that be fair to say? If this is your desire this morning, bow your heads as we pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we have heard your word. We have understood the clarity of your word, of the full cup principle and how you deal corporately with wickedness. Lord, we as a people, Lord, as a church, we are corrupt, we are wicked, Lord, and we are in need of your grace. And Father, we humble ourselves before you, Lord, and we ask for your Holy Spirit to open our eyes and anoint our eyes with salve that we may see, and that you open our understanding, Lord, and that you remove us from the state of lukewarmness, that you awaken us virgins and help us, Lord, to prepare before your soon coming. Please speak to each and every one of us as individuals. Convict us, Lord, of our sin and bring reformation in the lives. And I speak about myself first. Have mercy upon us. It is our prayer in the most precious name, the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you so much for coming. I guess, okay, there's a closing song.